Come on, V in Bible study. Come on. You won't get in trouble. Try one more time. Give it one more good one. Her skirt fell off already. Well, try her again. Try her again. Try her. Oh, it's right there. What's up, family? It's Tuesday. And we are live. Grab your Bibles. It's going to be a fun discussion tonight. What's up, y'all? Wait, try her again. Try her again. Grab your Bibles. We're going to hang out in John chapter 20. It's about to be good. It's about to be good. Lauren, what's happening? Courtney, what's going on? Pastor Lorraine, hello. What's going on, India? What's happening? Wait, come back. Is she little? Mm-mm, she's not gonna do it. Grab your Bibles. We're about to talk and have a really cool conversation. If you have ever struggled in your faith, this night is for you. If you have ever struggled with faith or with your faith, this one's for you. Say what's up. Okay, yes. Okay, let's go now. Say hi. Say hi. Am I supposed to move him out of it? No. Hold on. Say hi. Praise him, little. Praise him. Lift your hands. No, don't. Okay. Get your situation together. She off. Lord, you didn't let me sleep too late. Lord, you want me. 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 Circular praise. Bless him. He's worthy. Summertime. Nobody like Jesus. Say hi. Say nice things. Don't be weird about it. Okay, chill out. Chill out. You can stay right there. Grab your Bibles. John chapter 20. I'm going to give it 2 more minutes. You want to... You could just chill here. You don't have to leave. This is hilarious. This is my mother's doing, by the way. This whole... She has a pink peace shirt. This is a lot. With the whole green skirt. This is funny, dude. This is hilarious. What's going on? Hey, grab your Bibles. This is about to be good. Also, share this with somebody. Let somebody know we're on tonight. I knew that was gonna happen. Let somebody know that we're on tonight. I wanna talk about doubt. I wanna talk about what it is to have a crisis of faith and how you make it through that. Tell somebody we're on tonight. Send this to somebody who has ever been skeptical. I want to have that conversation tonight. Giving it 1 more minute. Thank y'all so much for joining in. Giving it 1 more minute. Oh, of course. Of course that's how that goes. Right when it gets good, that must be my time to start. Let's pray, and then I'm going to jump in. Father, thank you, because we wouldn't have made it through this day without you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for this opportunity we have to join together over your word and to find community. I thank you that everyone who's on this live and everyone who will watch this after this live is over is seen by you and loved by you and valued by you. So God, I pray that you would be with us, that you would speak to us in ways that only you can, and that out of this dialogue, out of this time spent, would come encouragement, strength, and love. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen. What's up, y'all? Here's the thing. We're going to John chapter 20. I'm picking up from last week where we started this discussion called QTNA, questions that need answers. Last week's question was, do I have enough? Is what I have enough? Am I enough? Because I want to unpack the questions that we're all asking, because We're all asking them. I think there's this facade that we have on social media that we all are not asking questions, that it can look like somebody who seems to have it all together because of what they're doing, because of their church membership or whatever, that they're not asking questions. And sometimes we like to scripture quote our way out of questions. We like to church dance our way out of questions. We like to spiritualize our way to make it seem like we know more and see more and are more confident than we really are. And I want to lead that discussion to say that I am a Christian. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ. I'm a pastor. But I also have questions, and those questions are ever evolving. Sometimes those questions come up because of a situation in life. Sometimes those questions come up because I meet someone who has a question that, even though I like to consider myself somewhat, to an extent, knowledge about the Bible and I've thought very critically, someone will bring up a question that I don't know the answer to. And what I'm learning is that many of us were brought up in faith experiences where there was no room for questions. There was just no room for questions. I want to put, have you ever asked a question about faith and got a negative reaction? I just want you to put that in the comments. Say, yeah, been there. Have you ever had a question about your faith, about something that was taught, about life, and the reaction was negative, where somebody tried to make you feel bad for your question, they tried to demonize your question, they tried to make you feel like because of your question, you didn't have faith, because of your question, you were rebellious. I know that sometimes we shorten that spectrum. I see some, yes, been there. I think sometimes we shorten the spectrum between question and rebellion. It means like, just because I have the question don't mean I ain't rebelled yet. I just have a question. And I want to unpack, I said this last week, if you didn't get a chance to start the beginning of this series, check that out. But I said this last week that there are a few reasons why we reject people when they have questions. Number one is because people are asking questions that we don't have answers to. And so instead of equipping people for how to go on that journey or being honest that we don't have the answer, it is way easier for me to just demonize your question. It's easier for me to make you feel bad for asking the question than it is for me to acknowledge that I don't know. Because what that would force people to do is it would force people to look at themselves and admit that there's still some growing I have to do on my journey. And if we're honest, that's very hard to do. I preached a message this past Sunday, hopefully I'll post it later this week, called It Hurts to Heal. I talked about how the reason why many of us don't get healed or don't go on these journeys is because it's so uncomfortable to do that. It's so hard staring that in the face for the first time where you're like, maybe I wasn't taught that either fully or correctly, or maybe I don't know that, or maybe I've been living my entire life not wanting to go through the discomfort of addressing that. So the reason why we do that to people who have questions, and the reason why that might have been done to you, was because the person who you were asking didn't have the answer. And they, instead of being honest about that, they wanted to hold on to the comfort of not knowing. You know, we hear the phrase all the time, ignorance is bliss, right? And so sometimes it's easier for me to make you feel bad for your question than it is for me to admit that I don't know. The second is that if we were to go down the corridors of certain questions, then that would then mean that in some situations we might have to give up power. Right? That I want to force my answer or no answer on you because I want to maintain power. Not only do I want to not go on that journey of figuring that out if I don't know the answer, but sometimes maybe people do know the answer, but there is this fear that if I lead you on that journey, you will regain control, you might revolt, who knows what you might do with this information, you might split the church, you might, whatever that might be. There's a large, broad spectrum. But the other is not just fear of somebody admitting to themselves that they don't know, but there's also a fear of what somebody might do with information if they did know. So sometimes we're like, let me keep you in your place, because if you know, particularly a lot of people in power, whether that power is preachers and pastors, whether that power is a professor, whether that power is a family member or a parent, typically we're afraid, or that person in power is afraid of what you might do with that information. So the point is, no matter how we respond to people and their questions, we all have them. At the end of the day, we all go to bed at night going, something about that I don't understand. Something about that don't sit right with me. Something about that is a little different. And what I want to do is I want to hold space for the questions that we're all asking, because every question that you have, someone has asked it before you, and somebody is asking it right now, okay? I'm going to say that again. Every question that you're asking right now, someone has asked it before you, and someone is asking it at this present moment. So I want to hold space for it. And what I've been doing is I've been going to the Bible to say, where were they asking questions? And what was the response when they had questions? So today, I want to talk about the doorway of doubt, the doorway of doubt, the doorway of doubt. I want to pose this as a question in the comments. Have you ever doubted what you believe? It's a scary question that most people don't ask. I want to ask you, for those of you who are on this live, have you ever doubted what you believed? Have you ever come to that point where you're like, I think, but I'm not sure? Have you ever gotten to that point where you're like, this is what I've heard, and it's what I think that I know, but sometimes I'm not sure how I know, or maybe I'm sure how I know, but I'm not sure if I want to stick with that. Have you ever doubted your faith? I'm going to go first and say, I know what it is to be at that spot where I'm like, I don't know, right? And mainly, it's when you get asked one of those questions and you're just like, oof, what do I do with this one? Have you ever doubted your faith? I just want you to throw that in the comments. Just say, yeah, like I've doubted. I have had doubts, or I have them currently, where I'm just like, what does this mean? How do I prove this? Was this right the way it was told to me? And I think sometimes we just do the work of going through the whole life, and we have that weird feeling in the pit of our stomach that's like, I don't know. So I want to take you into, I see some folks responding, some folks who are like, yes, yeah. We've all been there where you doubt and you're just like, I don't want to doubt. I want to feel like a good, strong, believing Christian. But if I'm honest, there's some moments where I'm just like, I don't know about this. So in John chapter 20, which is what I'm going to read today as I unpack, what is the doorway of doubt? What if doubt wasn't a dead end, but what if it was a doorway to a new path? That's what I want to wrestle with tonight in our text. What if doubt wasn't a dead end? What if it didn't have to be a dead end? But what if doubt was an invitation into digging deeper? What if doubt was an invitation into getting to know something different? What if doubt was merely the process of digging deeper? I'll stay with that language because I feel that. What if doubt was not necessarily a dead end that had some sort of identity attached to it? What if it wasn't like, you know, if you doubt, you're horrible. If you don't doubt, you're a great saint. But what if doubt was a doorway? What if it was a passage by which, if I engage it in a healthy way, might actually be the beginning of what deep relationship looks like? I'm going to say something that is profound and maybe even controversial, that real faith doesn't become anchored until I've been through a series of deep questioning. Can I say that again? That's going to be really controversial, but I want to show it in scripture that I believe that real true faith doesn't begin until it has come through a season of deep questioning. And there was a series in every believer's life in the Bible where we can trace there was a huge moment where they were asking a deep question, and it was on the other side of that question that their faith really began. I know you don't believe me, but it's in the text where there were some folks who believed, but it was when they went through that period where everything was kind of on the table, where the very core of who they were and what they believed was tested. On the other side of that was where true relationship and where true faith began. I want to start with the best example. I want to start with Jesus, that Jesus is someone who asks questions frequently. And Jesus is sometimes asking questions to sort of produce thought in the listeners. Sometimes Jesus asking questions that Jesus knows the answers to, but he's using it to sort of spur thought, to get people to see things in a new way. But I want to go to the kind of questions that Jesus is asking, right? Jesus said something interesting. He says, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And we know that there's some people who say, well, you know, he's just expressing how difficult it is to be on the cross. Yeah. But let's go deeper than that. I find it interesting that in the process of dying for our sins, Jesus has a question. And perhaps resurrection is on the other end of that question, that even Jesus has to deal with questioning the very presence of God. Brother Malik, what's going on, man? That Jesus has this wrestling in death of where God is. Whoo, can I say that again? Jesus, my Savior, who is the living picture of everything amazing, who is everything I will follow, who is the life after which I will pattern my own. To be a Christian means that I will follow Christ. In the process of dying for my sin, Jesus must go through questioning on the cross. That in dying, Jesus questions where God is. Can I pause there and say that if you've ever been there where you had that question, and again, if you study biblical history, we know that Jesus is also fulfilling sort of prophetically what is declared in the Psalms, that line, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And forgive my lack of true Jewish pronunciation on that phrase. But I think it's powerful to me that Jesus in that moment is engaged in question, is engaged in saying, where is God? So I want to let you know that if you've ever been there, where in the process of your understanding and in the process of sort of building and who you know God to be, if you've ever said, where is God? You're in company with Jesus Christ himself. So if we're going to build true relationship, then we can't erase doubt. But we also can't let doubt be the guiding factor of our relationship with Christ, because this is indeed a faith walk. And so what I want to offer based upon this scripture I'm about to read you is, what does that healthy construct look like? What does it mean to do doubt in a healthy way? What does it mean to engage our questions in a healthy way? Let me say this, that if God is God, surely God must be big enough for our questions. I want you to write that down in your notes. If God is God, then surely God must be big enough for our questions. If God created the earth, then surely God must not be intimidated when I have earth questions. Can I say that again? If God created the earth, then surely God is not intimidated when I ask earth questions. If God knows all, then God is not intimidated, insulted, standoffish when I ask questions, because God is big enough. God is big enough to handle my questions. God is big enough to handle my doubts. God is big enough, watch this, God is big enough to help me navigate the distance between God and I. Can I say that again? God is big enough to help me navigate the distance between God and I. There's distance in how much God knows and how much I know. There's distance in how much God sees versus what I see. There's distance in how much God can do versus what I can do. There's distance in God's motivations, which are always pure, and my motivations, which are sometimes spotty. There's a whole lot of distance between God and I. And the purpose of Jesus coming down was to live in my experience so that in the process of advocacy, that's why it's so important to see Jesus as being the one who advocates for us to the Father, because Jesus lived in my experience to decrease that gap. So Jesus is able to say, hey, I get it. I get what it is to be in that body. I get what it is to be on the earth. I get what it is to feel limited. I get what it is. And Jesus is this weird concept, because Jesus is eternity packaged in time. Imagine you are limitless, but you put limits on yourself so that you know what that's like to live the limited experience, so that you can then stand in between those with limits and the limitless God and be the advocate. I've got to get to our text, but I've got to set this up by letting you know that if you've ever had questions, there's space for that, and that healthy questioning, healthy doubt, healthy engagement of building what faith means. Here's the whole thing. If you get this, you got the whole thing. It means that I am engaging God in that questioning, as opposed to using the questions as a reason to be apart from God. Can I say that again? That in what I'm going to present to you, and this is the way that I am seeing it, the way that I'm seeing it in the text, and what I want to offer you from my heart. Engaging questions and doubt in a healthy way is when I allow those things to push me to engage God, to take those things to God, and to ask for clarity and engagement, instead of using those questions as a means to distance from God. And I'll talk about what all of that means in just a little bit, all right? Let's look at John chapter 20. Let me read this to you, because I think all of us are like this disciple. I heard something very powerful. I was watching somebody's story, and it was a group of brothers in Atlanta, I believe it was. They were talking about the scriptures, and one of the brothers said that all of us, the 12 disciples, represent aspects of all of us, right? Like sometimes we want to do like a match profile and say, which disciple are you? And then we could kind of pick, you know, well, you know, I'm Matthew, I'm John, I'm so-and-so. But this brother said something fascinating. He said, well, really the 12 disciples represent all of the facets of us, right? Sometimes we are outspoken and we're risk takers like Peter. And other times we fit the Judas mantra, right? We are traitors to Jesus Christ, the whole nine. And so there's a particular disciple who gets a bad rap in John 20. And what I find is that instead of looking at this disciple as being the bad one, it would be much more effective for us to find the ways in which this disciple is a part of all of us. Some of you already catch my drift because you know the Bible. I'm talking about Thomas. Thomas was a disciple, and it's interesting that Thomas is not mentioned many times, but this is Thomas's sweet spot. He comes to the center in this text in John chapter 20, beginning with verse 24, all right? I'm going to say there's a little bit of Thomas in all of us. Now, here's what's crazy is that most of us were told about Thomas, being introduced to Thomas by his doubt, where we called him Doubting Thomas. What's fascinating is that the scripture itself doesn't call Thomas that. We sort of put that on Thomas, that he's known for his doubt. Isn't it weird that sometimes when you have questions, people will label you for your questions instead of your faith? That people will say, oh, there's that one that is a rebel rouser and a fire starter, and there's that one that doesn't believe. And that's what we've done to Thomas, because it shows that we fundamentally don't know what to do with doubt, but Jesus did. And what I believe is that Jesus' response in this scripture, how Jesus deals with Thomas, is how Jesus deals with all of us when we know how to engage the doubts and the questions that we have. Let's read the text. Verse 24 says, but Thomas, one of the 12 called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. This is John chapter 20, verse 24. Verse 25. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we've seen the Lord. But Thomas said unto them, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again, the disciples were within and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst and said, peace be unto you. Then saith he to Thomas, reach hither thy finger and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing. And Thomas answered and said unto him, my Lord and my God. Jesus said unto him, Thomas, because thou hast seen me, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and yet have believed. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But they are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. Okay, let's get into this. Here is what's fascinating. The Bible says that they are all in this house together. Now, before we get into the doubt, I need us to situate what just happened before this. What just happened before this was Jesus had just been crucified and died. And the word was just getting out that maybe he might have been alive, but they really did not know. This is fascinating to me because we skip over that. We make that like a small thing because we're living on the other end of the story. But let's situate ourselves at that moment. I want you to imagine that you just gave 3 years of your entire life believing something was true, only to see it get defeated. Can I say that again? You just spent 3 years of your life. Jesus spent 3 years in public ministry. You just spent 3 years of your life and you left everything to make and build yourself on the identity of what you believed in this person, only for it to come back at you as a lie, only for it to come back to you as being defeated. And this is what is fascinating to me about this moment, is to me, the disciples represent that moment in all of our lives where it looks like what we built our lives on just got defeated. That to me is what's so powerful about this text. We read this backwards because we're on the other side of he got up and he's on the right hand of the Father and all that stuff. And while we know that in order to get the richness of the text, we have to put ourselves in their shoes. They were in that place where they said, wait. I just spent 3 years of my time, of my energy, of my money. But watch this. They had become known as Jesus's disciples. Here's what that means. That it wasn't just about belief for them, it was about identity for them. What does it mean to be a Christ follower if your Christ was dead? What does it mean to be a Christ follower if everything that he said he was, the state that killed him, just proved that maybe he wasn't that? So when they're here in this house, they're not just grieving the loss of their Savior, they're grieving the loss of their faith, and they're grieving the loss of their identity. Can I say that again? The disciples here in John chapter 20, when they are here and they haven't seen Jesus yet, they're grieving three things. Number one, their Savior was just killed. The person upon whom their faith was built, the person upon whom they believed that he was the Son of God. He said, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. This was their Savior. They believed that this was the Messiah. This is powerful. They're grieving their Savior. They're grieving their hero. But number two, they're also grieving their faith. What do we believe in now? And remember, they didn't just follow him. They were also preachers. Don't forget that Jesus commissioned them two by two when he was alive so they could get practice proclaiming Jesus's name. So they have preached this thing. So they're grieving their Savior. They're grieving their hero. They're grieving their faith, what they believed. And now they're also grieving their identity. This was not a small thing. And for many of us, the moment when you question your faith, the moment when life hands you questions you don't have answers to, the moment when you wrestle, the reason why it hurts so much is because people think you're just being weird. But in actuality, I'm grieving three things. I'm grieving that I don't feel my Savior. I'm grieving that my faith is being diminished because I was told this, but this is what my life looks like. But I'm also grieving my identity. This is why it's so hard, and this is why there is grace. Imagine people who grow up in the church and have something tragic happen. At that point, you're not just grieving your faith, you're also grieving your identity, because the churches and the places and what we believe, it's a part of identity formation. That's why, and I've been looking at a lot of stuff on social media in the past days where people are like going for blows about beliefs and scriptures and tactics and church experiences. You know why? Because not only are we processing faith, we're also processing identity. That's why when you say something about my belief system, I clap back, because I don't think you're just saying that about my interpretation of scripture. You're saying that about me, and vice versa. When you tell me that you believe X, Y, and Z, and that's different, bet you're saying that about me. And then likewise, when I say I don't rock with that, I'm saying that about you. And what is hard is, in these cases, the reason why we grieve and the reason why it hurts so much is because I'm trying to do the work of what I believe and who I am at the same time. And those works aren't always separate. In fact, they're oftentimes one and the same. That what I believe and who I am are tied to each other. So when one is attacked, the other is threatened as well. I love it. Somebody said it's like losing who you are and not even being able to recognize your own self. Absolutely. And I want us to find ourselves in the text with the disciples, that this is what they're up against, is who am I now? Do you know, and this is an unrelated story, but do you know that this is why Peter, who was an apostle, who had followed, do you know that this is why Peter went back to fishing? The Bible says that Jesus had to make a personal appearance to Peter to say, hey, do you love me? Because Peter was so devastated by the way this whole thing went down. You know what he did? He said, I will go back to the life I had before I believed in you, Jesus, because at least that life seemed more stable. Maybe that's who I am. Maybe I'm just a fisherman and not a fisher of men like you said I was. So for all of us, when we reach doubt, when we reach a stage in life where it challenges the very core of everything that we've thought and everything that we've felt and everything that we feel like we are, one of our responses is to go back to an identity that felt more stable, that was either pre-Christ or seems like an anti-Christ alternative. And so we have to see that. We have to see that in our own journeys. And we're going to have to see that when there are people around us who struggle with the faith and leave the faith. That we need to have grace that what they're dealing with is, I'm dealing with the fact that what I was taught and or what I believed and or what I had based my identity on, life has presented something different. And now I'm struggling to put the two together. The Bible says that in the midst of this, they are at this space grieving. They're at this space also afraid that now what had happened to the thing and the person that they put their belief in is going to happen to them too. So sometimes we run because we say, I don't want to end up like that. Have you ever seen what happened to someone who was full of faith and then decided that maybe it was time for you to leave yours because you didn't want to end up that way? Have you ever looked at someone who represented faith to you and then you saw something bad happen to that person and you said, well, if that happens to people who are full of faith, then I'll tell you what, I'ma just go this way. For some of us, that's our grandmother, right? Have you ever processed the passing away of someone who was full of faith? And you're like, wait. If they lived their life for God and they were full of faith and this is how their story ended, I'll tell you what, if that's what faith gets you, I'ma go over here. Sometimes we're processing what happens when when bad things happen to incredibly amazing people. And we're like, if that's what being amazing and being faithful gets you, I'm going to go over here. And I want you to see the disciples are struggling with that. If this is Jesus who is perfect, who's given his all, who has loved people and who has come to say great things. He was an advocate for women. He healed the sick. He taught. He prayed. He fed the 5,000. He was everything. And they killed him. That's why the disciples ran and hid, because they said, if they killed him and he was an amazing person, what do you think they're going to do to us? And many of us get to that same journey where we look at someone who represented goodness, who represented perfection, who represented faith. And we say, if that's what life dealt them, I might as well just go do my own thing and turn up. I want you to situate that it is on this backdrop that Jesus has this interaction with Thomas. It is on this backdrop that makes this so important. This is not just about this whole conversation that they have. It is about what Jesus does at a moment where you're wrestling with, how do I move forward from this? How do I move forward with what was taught and what I believed versus what seems to be reality? And what's the solution? Because my solution is to go do something else. So the story opens and it says that Thomas was not with them. I'm going to come back to that. The Bible says that the disciples then come to Thomas saying, yo, he's actually alive. You got to believe in him. It's all good. Like, this is great. Like, you, man, like, it's all good. You got to believe. And Thomas said, no, I got to see it. I got to see it. I want you to see parallels of Christianity in this exchange. I want you to see the parallel of someone who has reached a strong point in their faith, having a conversation with someone who is still struggling. Look at the dynamics of their excitement against or versus or adjoined towards Thomas's skepticism. It is their clarity positioned side by side with Thomas's cloudiness. That's what's crazy about this discussion. It's the disciples coming in clarity, but Thomas still being in cloudiness. It is the disciples being sure, but Thomas still being in his struggle. It is the disciples trying to get Thomas to be confirmed when in fact he's still questioning. And the Bible is allowing us to see them standing right across from each other. And the disciples are going, wait, it's good, it's good, it's good, believe. And Thomas is saying, I'm not sure yet. Wow. Have you ever been there? Have you ever been the one in the room who just wasn't sure? Like I'm not sure. I'm not certain. I hear you, but I'm not certain. I'm not 1,000%. There was something about Thomas's cloudiness that he's expressing to them. And he says, except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails and put my finger in the print of the nails and thrust my hands in his side, I will not believe. Here's what's powerful. Let's listen to their language. They said this: we have seen the Lord. Wow. The first time I looked at this text differently was when a mentor of mine, Pastor Dwight Radcliffe, presented this text in a way I'd never heard it. And he said this, because many of us will skip to what Jesus says, right? Which is when Jesus says at the end, blessed are those who have not seen and believed. But let's not rush to that, because why did the disciples believe? It's right there in verse 25. The disciples said to Thomas, we have seen the Lord. So in other words, it's not that Jesus is saying that there's no room for people who need to see to believe, because the only reason why the disciples believed in the first place was because they saw him. So in other words, it's not Thomas saying, I don't believe at all. It's Thomas saying, I need to experience this for myself in a new way in order for my faith to go forward. In other words, what allows us to get through the doorway of doubt to deep faith is the pursuit of personal experience. That is what is at the heart of this text that is different. It's not just don't doubt and don't be like Thomas because he doubted. Thomas is like many of us who says, I hear you, but I'm bold enough to ask for my own experience. And to me, this text is about how does Jesus respond when someone says, I won't believe until I have my own experience. That's what's at the heart of this text. It's how does Jesus respond when someone says, I hear you, and I'm glad that worked for you. And I'm pretty sure that what you're saying to me is exciting and well-intended and all that, but I will believe when that experience is made personal for me. Can I tell you that what's happening in our generation right now, what's happening in this present moment, are people saying, I can't hear you preach it. I can't just read it. I can't just YouTube it. I can Google a million things. What I need is an experience. And once I have a personal experience, that will be the edge and the determining factor of my belief. That's what's at the heart of this text is, does God make personal appearances? That's what's at the heart of the text. Does God make personal appearances? Or does God leave us to just hear it and say, you better believe because they said it. You better believe because it was spoken out there. Or does God make personal appearances? Doubt is a doorway when it leads for us to ask for our own personal experience. The disciples were only that hyped because they had seen Jesus first. That's what Pastor Dwight Radcliffe taught me. They were only excited because they saw Jesus first. Thomas is only asking to be able to be as excited as they are by having a similar experience that they had. And can I suggest that if we're going to help people navigate through doubt, that we have to be pushing them towards a personal experience with God, not just more scripture and not just testimony and not just, thank you, Holy Ghost. This is a part of why the Bible says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, because when I hear your testimony, it helps me hear how God personally visited you so that then I can use that as influence for how he might, for how God might personally visit me. That's why it's important for us to share our testimonies, because I don't just want to hear a bunch of philosophies and thoughts. I want to hear, what house were you in when God visited you? What place of darkness and despair and confusion and doubt and frustration? Where were you when God visited you? Where were you when God made God's self real to you? Where were you when it became less and less about what was being said on Sunday and the outfits and the music? And where were you when it became real? Where were you when it became personal? Where were you when you saw God for the first time? And maybe by hearing that, I can also learn how God might come visit me. Where were you? Were you in the club? Were you high? Were you in a Bible study? Were you not in a Bible study? Were you in college? Were you in a bad relationship? Were you in a good relationship? Were you in the midst of a personal health crisis? Were you moving out of your house for the first time? Where were you when God became real? Where were you when God leaped out of the pages, when God became more than a book and became an experience? Where were you when you heard something audible? Do you hear the voice of God audibly? Where were you? Or do you feel something in your gut? Where were you when it became less about the songs and more about the tears? Where were you? Were you depressed? Were you harming yourself? Where were you? And what was your identity at that point? What did you know yourself to be? Did you identify as Christian at that point? Maybe you identified yourself as not Christian. Were you pursuing a different religion? Were you married? Were you single? Were you in multiple relationships? Were you in a situationship? Were you incarcerated? Were you pursuing a dream? Were you not pursuing a dream? Were things going great for you? Did you have a lot of money? Where were you? What did your house look like when God showed up to you? And tell me that, and then allow me space for God to visit me too. Will God visit me too? Will God visit me as well? Will God make a house call like a good barber or a good physician? Will God show up where I am? Is God only in the four walls, or will God become real in my experience? Thomas says, look, I'm glad y'all are happy. I really am. But I can't just take your word for it. And can I tell you that while many people are demonizing a generation, what's really happening is it's a group of people that for the first time in a minute is saying, I'm not going to take your word for it. And the reason why we are oftentimes challenged as a church is because we only know how to create church experience, not Jesus experience. And when you only know how to create one, you feel helpless when somebody needs the other. Because this kind of experience is not going to happen in front of 50 people. It's going to happen in a room with you and Jesus. Can I say that again? This type of experience in John chapter 20 that reshapes your faith forever is not going to happen in a bunch of people. It's not going to happen. In fact, it's not even going to take place on social media. You won't be able to capture it in a post. You won't have words to describe it. You won't have a cute picture to post about it. What's really going to happen is it's going to be deep. It's going to be entrenched, and it's going to be personal. And Jesus is going to make Jesus' self present for you personally. The Bible says something interesting. My time is almost up, but the Bible says something interesting here. That it says in verse 24, Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So that means something happened that they got to experience that Thomas didn't. Well, what happened? Let's read verse 19. Verse 18 first says, Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord and that he had spoken these things to her. Okay, fantastic. So it always happens this way. I hear about God word of mouth first, but then I need a personal experience to supplement what was heard. Okay. Bible says faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. How can they hear except there be a preacher? How can he preach except he be sent? So there is something to be said about us spreading the gospel, talking about it, being in community and teaching. That is important. But then that teaching needs to be followed up by how do we equip people to go on their journey to experience God personally? Because it happens this way. They heard first, then Jesus made an appearance. Can I say that again? They heard first, then Jesus made an experience. The doorway of doubt is that it takes me from hearing to experience. That doubt is the space between hearing and experience. That it goes, I've heard, but now I want an experience to supplement what I've heard so I know it's real. Thomas was like, show me the scar so I know it's real. But that wasn't unique. It wasn't Thomas being different or weird, because the disciples heard it from Mary Magdalene first, but they too need an experience. So the Bible says, then the same day at evening, verse 19, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut, where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst and said unto them, peace be unto you. I need to pause here because this is powerful. I want you to hear what they said. Their fear, remember, they're grieving three things. They're grieving their Savior, they're grieving the loss of their faith, and they're grieving the loss of their identity. Watch this. The Bible says that they were in a house where the doors were shut and locked to protect themselves. Watch this. And what Jesus does is he appears through the wall. I feel like preaching. Okay. First of all, we have to see that the Bible is in many senses presenting to us a literal miracle here, right? That Jesus is ascended and does the literal miracle of walking through a wall. But I also want us to look at the figurative meaning of that. The doors were locked because they were afraid, but Jesus was strong and powerful enough to make it through the walls that they had built to keep Jesus out. That means that when you and I, in the name of our doubt, build up walls around ourselves to prevent ourselves from being hurt again, to prevent ourselves from being afraid again, to prevent ourselves from being intruded upon again. Oh, you know what it is when you've been hurt. And so we have a tendency to develop walls because we're like, I can't be hurt like that again. I don't want anybody to come at me. I don't want that threat. I don't want these things against me. And so we know what it is to struggle. And so we know what it is to build up those walls to protect ourselves. I tell you what, I'm never going to that church again. I'm never listening to that preacher again. I'm never talking to my family about this again. I'm never going to be honest again. All of the walls that we build up, I'm never getting in another relationship. I'm not going to believe in love again. I'm not going to believe in the possibility of freedom or hope or justice. And we build up these walls to secure our hearts. But I'm here to tell you that just like Jesus did in John chapter 20, verse 19, Jesus is strong enough to appear through the walls. That's so powerful. Jesus is strong enough to make it through a door that we might even not let him in. They didn't unlock the door. Jesus just casually made his way through. They didn't move anything. And I love it because the hymn writer said, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found." Now, here's what's interesting. I am found. That means I didn't find God. God found me. That the work of redemption is really a God work. It is God reaching past my walls and coming to get me. So I want to liberate anybody who has been made to feel bad that you have to sort of pull yourself up by the bootstraps of your own faith and just sort of miraculously be at a place where you were not. No, my Bible tells me that when I shut myself up inside and close the door, God comes running after me. Surely goodness and mercy will run after me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever, not because I want to, but because Jesus walks through my walls. I feel the power of the Almighty God coming through this. Jesus walks through my walls. He walks through my walls of fear. He walks through my walls of complacency. He walks through my walls of being angry. He walks through my walls of bitterness. He walks through my confused walls. He walks through my walls where I'm just trying to be safe. He walks through all of those walls. And watch this. When he walks through the walls, you know what he does? The first thing he says is not, "Why didn't you believe?" He doesn't say, "I'm mad at you." He doesn't say, "I'm over this." He doesn't say, "How many times do I have to prove this?" He doesn't say, "Did you forget all that stuff I did for you 3 years?" You know what he says? He says, "Peace be unto you." Why? Because he knows why I'm afraid. He knows what sent me into this room. He knows why I'm under these walls. He knows why I built the walls up. And so what Jesus does is, number one, he comes to get me when I'm too far to be able to get him. And then number two, the first thing that he says is, "Peace, Princeton. Peace. It's all right. I'm here. Peace to your heart. Peace to that place of you that's questioning. Peace to that place that is having a hard time reconciling what is versus what you believe. Peace to that place that doesn't feel like God is there. Peace to the part of you that is grieving your Savior, your faith, and your identity. Look, I'm here." And here's what I love. Before Jesus fixes faith, he first acknowledges his presence. I'm gonna run around this table. Before Jesus has a conversation about faith, he first just wants to remind you, "I'm right here." Because the beauty of it is, what I'm really having a hard time believing is, "Are you here? Are you real? And how's all this work?" That's my follow-up question. But my first question is, "Are you here? Because it looked like you're dead." And Jesus says, "The first thing I just need to do before we talk about faith, I just want to let you know I'm here. I'm right here. Peace be unto you. I'm right here." Peace be unto your heart. Peace be unto your spirit. I'm right here. Jesus makes his way through the walls. He makes his way through the things that I have built up to enclose myself because I'm afraid that what happened to him might happen to me, and I can't afford that. I can't grieve. Oh my goodness. Woo! Some of you are on this live and you're struggling because you're grieving and you're afraid at the same time. And what we don't talk about enough is oftentimes we talk about depression or anxiety, but we don't talk about how many of us are feeling both at the same time. I'm depressed because I'm grieving the past, but I'm anxious about what might come into my future as a result of my past. And so I'm doing this difficult dance between my depression and my anxiety at any point in the day. And I need Jesus to speak peace to both. I need Jesus to speak peace to the past that I'm grieving, and I need Jesus to speak peace to the future I'm afraid of. I got to leave you. Can I say that again? I need Jesus. The reason why he has to say peace, I need Jesus to speak peace to the past I'm grieving. And I need Jesus to speak peace to the future that I'm afraid of. And Jesus does both. Watch this. I got to read this to you. We're almost done. The Bible says, peace be unto you. Verse 20, chapter 20, verse 20. And when he had so said, he showed unto them his hands and his side. Watch this. They did not ask to see it. Jesus offered what they needed for faith's sake. Can I tell you this? Jesus, they did not ask. They didn't ask. They didn't ask. They're just sitting there like, and Jesus says, come, touch this. Experience me. Let's get intimate. Can I pause here and insert that you will know true love because true love will offer proof of belief before initiating relationship. Can I say that again? You will know true love when it shows up in your life because it will offer proof for belief before initiating relationship. Before Jesus says, pray to me, before Jesus says, get right, before Jesus says any of that, he says, let me offer you the fullness of who I am. Let me show you who and what I really am. And let me give you reason up front to show what my intentions and what my heart and my realness are. This is what I love about God. God always goes first. That's how you know love is present, because love goes first. Love doesn't wait for you to speak out. Love doesn't wait for you to apologize. Love says, let me go first. You will know true love because true love will stand and offer what needs to come about to show pureness and to show realness even before you've asked for it. He says, look, watch this. The Bible says, then were the disciples glad. Why were they glad? They were glad, the Bible says, when they saw the Lord. Then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father has sent me, even so I send you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins ye remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins ye retain, they are retained. Here's what I need you to catch from that. Jesus empowered them for ministry after they had personal experience. It was fruitless for him to just send them out to be preachers before he dealt with their need to be intimate with their Savior again. And the true work of intimacy, I could spend so much time on this text. The true work of intimacy is scar bearing. The true work of intimacy is scar bearing. Who has seen my scars? That's who I've been intimate with. Who has seen the most raw, vulnerable parts of me, and who have I allowed to not just see it, but to touch it? That's who I've been intimate with. And Jesus says, before I make you represent me, I need to be vulnerable enough with you to allow for an intimacy that has you be in touch with my wounds. That means I can't really do great ministry if I haven't spent time identifying with the wounds of Jesus. If Jesus and I have not gotten close on the wound level, I might not be ready for ministry. if Jesus and I have not gotten intimate on the wound level, if we have not had an opportunity to meditate and to process wound to wound, hurt to hurt, heartbreak to heartbreak, peace to peace, broken soul to broken soul, because he was wounded for my transgressions and bruised for my iniquities, the chastisement of my peace was upon him, and by his stripes I'm healed. That's why Paul says that I might know him. Watch this, in the power of his resurrection, but in the fellowship of his suffering. Preaching ain't preaching until I've identified with him on the wound level. My brand, you know, I know we got great t-shirts and a website and all that, but that ain't popping until I've identified with Jesus on the wound level. Watch this. After Jesus related to them, then he empowered them. Can I say that again? After Jesus related to them, then he commissioned them. He said, now that we've had this experience, now go represent me. Because when you've had an experience, no one can take that away from you. When you've had an experience, no one can steal that. When you've had an experience, watch this. Now that we're bound on the wound level, we could figure the rest of this out. Once we've been at the wound level, listen, the rest of, you know, the Nicene Creed and the Book of Acts and when the Holy Ghost is going to fall, and we can figure all of that out because we've been connected at the wound level. So when you read that, you realize that Thomas's doubt wasn't a dead end. It was a doorway. Because he wasn't saying he hated Jesus or didn't believe. He was saying, I want to have the same experience that you all had. Here's the hope, and I'm going to leave you. Jesus made a second appearance just for Thomas. Jesus could have said, Thomas, they told you, they saw me, believe them. But no, Jesus loved Thomas enough to say, I'll appear and I'll do the same thing over again just for you. Because it matters to me that much that you are one of my disciples, and I want you to have an intimate experience with my wounds the same way they did. And can I tell you what was cool about Thomas? And I'm gone. The Bible says that the disciples, when Jesus came and appeared the first time, he showed it to them. But when Jesus came to Thomas, he said, touch it. Whew. Oh my goodness. Get the experience level. Here's all I came to say because my time is up. Doubt is a doorway when it leads us to move towards experience. I'll talk about this more next week. Don't feel bad. Invite God and do what Thomas did and say, Lord, I've heard about you. I want to experience you and I want to get to know you on the wound level. I'll see y'all next week. Love you.